President Aquino has tasked a team to look into the country's claim to Saba, insisting the matter should be settled through legal means. Meanwhile, questions have been raised on the legitimacy of the Kiram family. So joining us this morning to help us understand the whole Saba claim, the issue, the history, is Presidential Communications Development and Strategic Planning Office Undersecretary Manolo Quezon III. Yusek, it's good to see you again. Welcome back to ANC.
Thanks. All right. Nice to be back.
You know, for those who may be interested, Manolo, the Yusek has a timeline here. It's very thick, okay? Very, very thick. I'm actually trying to read through it. It starts at 1640.
Yes. Let me point out, Pinky, that this is, the Senate President might say, the product of my own mind. It's not an official position paper of the government. So let's get that clear. It's research that I put forward simply because I think it's in everyone's interest to get a grasp of what are the issues out there and what does the literature tell us.
When did you do
this? Part of the explainer before, I was doing that, so there's a certain amount. I've been writing about this for 20 years.
Really?
Then it was putting together, finally, in a timeline form, what will help. And I'm glad that that people have been reading it.
Okay, first, this is my question. How factual is this?
Well, it's documented. I mean, I tried to footnote it as extensively as possible. You know, you don't take one person's word for it. You survey what's out there, what people have said. And you can make up your own mind by doing further reading if you want.
All right. So this is your disclaimer that this is not the position of the palace. This is, of course, Manolo has been with us for those, you know, who might have remembered. It wasn't such a long time, though. He was the explainer. So today he will be our explainer again. I'm not going to go back. I just want to go back to one thing, Yusek. First is, how far back does this go, this claim on Saba?
Well, you have to start at the very, very start, which is that this was all property of the Sultan of Brunei. And at a certain point, he gave a big chunk of what he owned in his part of Borneo to the Sultan of Sulu. And this is about the 1700s.
Why?
There had been a rebellion, right. And the Sultan of Sulu sent some help. And then, so, you know, the Sultan of Brunei and other leaders in that sort of setup would give little chunks of what they owned, you know, for that sort of arrangement. Now, the Sultan of Sulu, in turn, once he had this property, actually in about 1800 to 1850, he gave away one chunk. Actually, he sort of put a chunk under the control of another sultan, who promptly gave it away to the British, to the Dutch. Then in 1878, he had the remaining chunk, and the whole controversy is whether he leased it or sold it to a company called the British North Borneo Company. That's eventually how it was recognized.
Wait a minute. Was this the first chunk you were talking about?
No, the first
chunk. Remaining one.
Yes, it's okay. The remaining one.
Right.
And this is what we know as Saba, basically.
All right. Because the first one was to the Dutch.
Given to another sultan who, in turn, sort of gave it to the Dutch.
And
so it's part of Indonesia now.
Bigay lang yung Dutch.
Yeah, because, you know, that's a long story, and you can ask the archaeologists and the sociologists about that sort of thing. Now, so the whole question is a couple. The whole controversy is whether it was sold or rented. Yes, leased. Whatever the case, the continuing sort of arrangement has been that the heirs of the sultanate receive a yearly annual payment. Now, in turn, the sultanate itself would sometimes accept the control of the Spanish, sometimes not. In the end, the Americans took over the Philippines. And in 1915, there was an agreement that put an end to the sort of the existence of the Sultanate of Sulu as a country as we know it. Basically, what the Sultan of Sulu at that time accepted through the Carpenter Agreement was, I recognize the sovereignty of the United States, and in exchange, I get property, I get an allowance, and I am recognized as the spiritual leader of the Muslims in my old territories. Now, then, there is a continuing controversy because what about, this is all about Sulu, but what about his claim on North Borneo, which is by this time under the protection and basic control of the British? And that has been the continuing sore point there, because then the British were doing their own maneuverings, including first declaring it a protectorate and then actually annexing it right after we became independent in 1946 and making it a crown colony and then handing it over to Malaysia. And the other weakness in this is that at a certain point, after the last sort of uncontested sultan dies in 1936, there's almost 20 years where the heirs are fighting among themselves and can't agree on who will be the actual sultan. In 1950, it's sort of finally resolved. And after that, you start seeing things move faster. The sultan at the time, Ismail, decides by the 1960s, and this is what we all know from our textbooks in school, in the 1960s, he gives an instrument to the Philippine government under President Macapagal and says, whatever sovereign rights and all other rights I have over my property in North Borneo, I assign to the Republic of the Philippines. And that's when the government started going out to
lay its claim.
Now, why were we laying our claim at that particular point of time? Because that's the point in time when the colony of North Borneo, a British colony by this time, there's already talk that it is going to be handed over to the new government of Malaysia. And so the Philippines felt it had to act, because otherwise
we would have lost it completely.
Now, certain things intervene at that point. First, the British go through something called the Cobalt Commission, which makes a big to-do about, you know, consulting people. And in their own findings, they said one-third wanted to join Malaysia, one-third wanted to join Malaysia with reservations, and one-third was against. Anyway, they do it. The UN steps in. And at that point in time, the Secretary General of the United Nations was Utant Burmese, and he sent a commission. They did a study. Utant issued a report saying, as far as we've been able to tell, they want to join Malaysia. Mm-hmm. And that's why Malaysia becomes independent 2 days after Utant issues his report. Of course, the Philippines and Indonesia, who all have interests in this part of the world. Remember, the biggest chunk of Borneo is owned by Indonesia, mm-hmm. as a successor to the Dutch, used to own everything there. And the other part, the British, and through the British, Malaysia has an interest. Anyway, since then, we've sort of been at irreconcilable differences, to put it mildly. In 1977, President Marcos made an announcement that he was going to take steps to formally abandon the
claim. Wait a minute. So we get to President Ferdinand Marcos. During the time of the president, was Sabah or North Borneo already with the Malaysians?
Yes.
Diba? Okay. I'm sorry, you lost me somewhere when you said that the Sultanate, Ismail, had already said, I cease.
I assign all my. Remember, there are two rights that the Sultanate had. One as a sovereign, because, you know, in simplest terms, the Sultan is a kind of king. And therefore, as a king, you have a kingdom, which is a country. And that country has sovereign rights. You know, you can collect taxes, etc., etc., etc. Now, you also have, as the head of the family or as a member of a family that owns a piece of property, you have proprietary mm-hmm. rights. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what the family decided was, we assign our sovereign rights to the Republic of the Philippines.
So that's giving it away, basically. Yeah.
And second was, we maintain our proprietary rights, which is we're entitled to some sort of compensation, etc. But we assign, sort of as our lawyer, the one to take care of pushing for this, the Republic also.
Okay.
So there are two issues at hand here. So we were talking about the way this was sort of resolved as far as the UN was concerned, as far as the Malaysians were concerned. Indonesia and the Philippines didn't accept that. President Marcos's dilemma was that because you were faced with all these sort of blocks to the Philippine claim, mm-hmm. He undertook something that was known as Operation Merdeka. And we all know how that ended up. I mean, that was what led to the expose by Senator Ninoy Aquino of the Jabida massacre. And in turn, that had its own set of consequences. It was one of the triggers for the rebellion in the South among our Mora brethren, and it also had repercussions with Malaysia, which has, you know, which was has remained constantly concerned about this. Long short of it, by 1977, in Kuala Lumpur, President Marcos made a statement that they wanted to resolve this issue. And this was repeated by Arturo Tolentino. And it's sort of been on the back burner. Not yet vice president. He was involved. He was an MP by then. And so,
are you talking about this when he said that...
Yes, that's what President Marcos...
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
And then it's repeated by Tolentino.
All right. So here, just to inform our viewers, this is the one. President Marcos gives up claim to Sabah. This is in 1977. At this point in Marcos's presidency, a legislature has not yet been convened. Therefore, President Marcos exercised full authority over the foreign affairs policy. And after this, but Malaysia asked for two things from the Philippines.
Yes.
Number one, the 1973 Constitution is broad, and in order to eliminate the clause, they wanted to eliminate the clause, territories belonging, this is the contentious issue, mm-hmm. territories belonging to the Philippines by historic right or legal title, and number two, that RA 5446, particularly Section 2, be repealed. Okay.
So, and for those who are watching, shameless plug, please go to quezon.ph because you'll get an idea of what Pinky and I are talking about. So, I mean, if you
want to
boil it down.
Sorry, Manala. Yeah. Then let's go here. The Malaysian Foreign Ministry said a verbal announcement of the Philippines that it has dropped the claim is not enough. Okay, so that was not enough for the Malaysians. Go on.
Yeah, the Malaysians basically had two conditions that we had to amend our constitution and our baseline laws. Now, if you wanted to step back, because, you know, a lot of people are getting a nosebleed over this.
Including me.
Okay. No, but, I mean, you have a basic claim. Okay, let's review it. The Sultan of Sulu or the heirs of the Sultanate of Sulu have two basic questions. The first is their proprietary rights, and the second was the sovereign rights, which they resolved, both of these, by assigning it to the Republic. Second is the Philippines, in making its claim, is bound by certain behavior. The Philippines has renounced war as an instrument of national policy, which is what made, for example, Operation Merdeka quite an interesting thing. The second is that we adopt international law as part of the law of the land, which means you have to resolve these things in an international
Correct.
Arena.
Mm-hmm.
You have the further complication that the UN at a certain point stepped in. You mm-hmm. have the fourth complication that the world has moved on since 1962. In 1963, 1964, when our basically national memory of this was formed. And so you have to look at certain things, and that's why I suppose there's an extensive legal study taking place, because earlier in this decade, about 2001 to 2007, Indonesia and Malaysia went to the International Court of Justice to resolve a part of their claims in Borneo. And if you review the decision of the International Court of Justice, they said, okay, Malaysia and Indonesia went to us, they're fighting over the little bunch of islands over here, and the first thing both governments did was they brought out all these antique documents and started laying out all their historical claims. And the court said, we set aside all of those.
Really?
They are not particularly relevant at this point. Therefore, let us go to the second way of resolving this. The question is, were they just sort of empty islands that they hopped onto? No, because precisely they were part of older organizations of things and borders and that sort of thing. So we will resolve this by looking at who has been actually handling things there. In the end, anyway, Malaysia wins. Now, why is this important? The Philippines tried to intervene in that case. They made a petition to intervene precisely to assert our argument for things. This was rejected by the International
why?
Court of Justice. Well, they said, you know, you are trying to intervene, but this is between Malaysia and Indonesia, and you're not directly...
Wait a minute. So USEC, then the government can actually really bring this before the International Court of Justice.
To my understanding, and it will take a lawyer to answer this with certainty, my understanding is it will only work if both of you agree. Right? That's a problem. But
okay.
What the main point to consider here is, if you are looking at the framework based on very old documents and decisions made by, you know, ways of governing that no longer exist, and intervening events such as the UN and that sort of thing, there's a third aspect to this, which is that the thought of the world, for a lack of better way of expressing it, has moved on since the 1960s, and that there are other considerations to be made. One sort of opinion that was made by one of the justices involved in this International Court of Justice decision said that, raised a point which I think no one can ignore, which is, are territories to be decided by what kings and old empires had done to divide the world among themselves, or should it be determined on what the people in that particular part of the world want for themselves? I mean, even for us.
Are you saying then and now, then versus now? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, because remember, we are all, in a sense, arguing this on the basis of historical lines. And I mean, even former Senator Sagisag in a recent letter pointed out, don't forget that as Filipinos, we are Filipinos because we said we want to be Filipinos. In a sense, he was, if I understand him correctly, he was saying the right to self-determination trumps everything, or at the very least, is an aspect we cannot ignore. We cannot argue this on the basis of old kingdoms and empires.
All right, but let's talk about the past presidents, just very briefly, Yusek. During the time of President Marcos, please correct me if I'm wrong, he gave up claim on Sabah.
Well, you know, President Marcos, as you know, was a very clever man. And so he said, we will take steps.
Yeah, okay.
And that's why Malaysia makes its counter gambit, which is, we're not going to take
the
word
for
it.
I want the two provisions here.
Yeah.
What happened after that?
Well,
so
this
we
was,
can go.
Yes, we, as you know, we don't we're not under the 1973 Constitution anymore. And the particularly objectionable...
So nabitin yun doon. Is that
hindi,
so?
Ganito, ha? Malaysia made two demands. Take out right of historical title, etc., from your constitution. And second, amend your baseline laws. Okay? So what happens? In our new constitution, in the 1987 constitution, that phrase is no longer there. Now,
which one? The baseline?
The historical claim. Mm-hmm. Now, if you go to the journal of the Constitutional Convention, there was a huge debate. Does this mean we're giving up our claim, or doesn't this mean? And it seems that the general consensus is, no, we're taking it out, but it doesn't mean we're giving it up.
We're
so
giving up our claim.
You can say it's status quo, but less, perhaps, less controversial in the way it's phrased. The second was that in 2009, we finally amended the baseline law. But then the Supreme Court issued a decision a few years later and said that even though you have amended the baseline law, it does not give up our claim.
Historic, okay.
So,
okay.
Then that's it is where it is.
Yeah.
So,
so we go to the 1986 Constitution. You had already talked about that. Let's talk about how the president then, Corazon Aquino, tried to settle the issue in terms of heirs, ownership.
Okay.
Who's the rightful heir?
Your problem is that in 1986, the last sort of acknowledged sultan died.
And, who is?
It's there
here,
in the chart.
Here, let me help
report.
You.
Yes,
I'm kidding. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
I'll look for it.
Now, if you look at the chart, he's the last acknowledged sultan where, because, you know, It's a different culture from the way many of us understand things. Yes, it's Ismail. It's Ismail's son who becomes Mahakuta Kiram, and he dies in 1986.
Okay.
The now when he dies in 1986, basically, if you wanted to give the Reader's Digest condensed version of this, that there has to be unanimity among the heirs, and second of all, it has to be ratified by the royal council for there to be a sultan to emerge, and therefore many of the discussions will be easier if you have a sultan there. The problem is the government cannot just say, hey, you're going to be sultan, because remember our constitution, we cannot enact titles of nobility and that sort of thing. So it is a purely the authority and responsibility of those royal involved in selecting the sultan. And they, only then can the government deal with the that person.
Absolutely. It's like they have to wait to choose their leader and government can deal with it. It's as simple as that. Why did they not, why was there a problem after 1986?
Because just as there has been a problem earlier from the 30s to the 1950, which was that there different people were coming forward to say I have a stronger claim to be the next sultan, and if you look at what has been written about it, basically different presidents tried to get them together and say, will you please,
President Ramos,
President Aquino, President Ramos, even President Arroyo. The problem is, since you need to have a understanding among everyone involved, if one or two or a group say no, then you're back to square one.
But I remember speaking to Secretary Edwin Lacerda. Did he say, I'm not sure if he said Royal Council also, but there is a council there that is supposed to be...
Yes, precisely. But it has to be, you know, in traditional cultures, it's not just majority rules. I mean, that's the way we do
What's
it, let's
it
say,
like?
In an election. It has to be, you know, the elders must have a unified voice. That is how you maintain both the prestige and authority, to have a unified voice, because they...
And there, I guess there's no unified voice.
There isn't. Well, I mean, if you look at the
family tree... Wait a minute, are you telling me that if one of the elderly members actually oppose the appointment of a sultanate, then all that is lost? It's supposed to be all or nothing, parang ganun ba?
It should be, because again, that is the whole basis of you don't elect them, they don't run for office, so it has to be that the semblance of unity of the elders is maintained.
And that causes a huge problem, because from the time, for example, let's just go back to President, the late President Cory Aquino, till now, there's been no, please correct me, sultanate that was appointed or elected by the Royal Council.
That seems to be the case. And in fact, you have a problem where among those who have put forward their claim to be sultan is Jamalut Kiram III, who you see on TV. His brother is also claiming to be the sultan. They have basically a first cousin and a nephew who also had claims. So you have all these sort of simultaneous claims, and until it can be resolved in and among themselves, it leaves, in a sense, government in a quandary, and it's a sort of a political issue among themselves. Okay. Now
that we can't really delve our the government can't delve their fingers into. Okay.
Well, yeah, I mean,
at least on that matter.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
So we go fast forward. Where, at least the Philippines' claim on Sabah, where does it presently stand now? I understand, of course, Manolo, that the president asked the DOJ, the DFA, to study this. But prior to this thing happening, this incident happening in Sabah, where was our claim?
It was perhaps a good way to express it is in sort of... suspended animation. I mean, it's there. It's a matter of record. I think it would be fair to say we had gone as far as we could go, considering the fact that the eventual resolution of everything is in the international arena, and as I pointed out earlier, after a certain extent, it requires sort of all sides to come to the table.
But is there something pending before the International Court of Justice?
As far as I know, but you would have to ask the DFA and the DOJ.
As far as, you know,
as far as I know,
there's nothing.
Because you would need both. I mean, for example, look at how the question of those islands in North Borneo was resolved. It was Indonesia and Malaysia
coming together,
and saying, we leave it up to the court to decide.
There was an agreement between both parties to have the International Court of Justice decide on this. That probably will be a problem for us, because Malaysia... Would Malaysia even want to bring this to the International Court of Justice?
Well, in the past...
Well, I mean, why would someone...
Let me point out something. It's very interesting. You know, when I started doing research on this, I was actually looking as... I was sort of putting on my pre-government hat and saying, are we just sort of going backwards and forwards? It's interesting. There's a certain consistency in over 40, 50 years in the Philippines' position, which is... as good citizens of the world, we would prefer a neutral arbiter, which is an international court, to resolve this, and we'll accept whatever happens. That's a pretty big leap of faith. There's no difference from Makapagal to the present. I mean, you look at any other case where we have a disagreement with another country, yeah. It's, in let's say, in DFA language, it's a rules-based approach,
okay.
Right? So, to that extent, the Philippine approach has always been consistent,
yeah.
And always, in a sense, a good
to this day.
Boy Scout. Yes.
Yeah.
Problem is, you cannot... It
you
takes two people to go to court.
For example, the Philippines and China, for that matter, right? We want to bring the matter to the international court on the law of the seas.
Yes.
But China doesn't want to do
yes.
that, right?
But at least from our part, we're just saying, look, this is our position. We want this resolved peacefully.
Yeah.
We want it resolved in a way that is acceptable to all.
But let me ask you this, Yusek. Because Sabah is known to be part of Malaysia, why would Malaysia even want to bring this, or willingly, or voluntarily want to bring this in the International Court
of Justice?
I don't
want to comment on something that would affect the, let's say, the politics of the Malaysian government, whether it's a private citizen or anything.
Actually, I'm just thinking
but
common
if you were
sense
to look,
wise.
If you were to look at the sort of the grand geopolitics of it all, of course, a lingering issue is sort of a slow burn. And it leads to a certain amount of discomfort, and you're never sure. And if there's one thing I think no government likes, it's uncertainty. However, you do have different pressures. You have domestic pressure on a national level and on a regional level, meaning, and you see it in the Philippines. So let me set aside commenting on Malaysia and say, what a government says will play out in the national media and be commented on in the regional media,
yeah, yeah.
Right? And those are two kinds of political pressures. There's the pressure from your other neighbors who also don't want things getting too messy
conflicted.
Because then it has a spillover yeah. effect, and then it has a sort of global implication because you'd have different alliances. Mm. You would want to perhaps resolve this, but again, it depends on, there is something to be said that to letting sleeping dogs lie is also a policy option.
Yeah, yeah.
It is a policy option because you have different priorities
mm-hmm.
coming in.
Mm-hmm.
You may want to fix this lingering age-old problem, but you have something that can pay more immediate dividends, let's say. So you only have X amount of energy, X amount of political capital. What are you going to spend it on?
Yeah. Which one will you prioritize,
yeah.
right? Where are you going to focus on? I guess, I just want a little bit of what is factual or, you know, what common sense dictates right now. To me, there are two things. I mean, I don't know if you're going to want to comment on this. When you say Sabah, it's Sabah, comma, Malaysia.
Well, actually, that's an interesting point because Sabah is the Malaysian term for that federal state.
Okay.
That is correct. And so in a sense, it would be more accurate for a Filipino to refer to it as North Borneo,
mm-hmm.
perhaps.
Number two, I guess to the minds of many, just, I guess because it's unfair to ask just one or two questions about this, but because of the history, everything, everything that started since way, way back, people are still asking for one thing. If it isn't the Philippines or if it isn't the Sultan's ownership, why are they being paid lease? Right? I mean, those are common sense, practical questions being asked. But again, we go back to how complicated this problem is from way, way back.
It is complicated because, again, we seem to take the view that there's only one history. And just as your experience with your family will be different from mine, we each carry our own histories. A Moro's approach to history will be different, let's
yeah,
say, from a Christian Filipinos.
That's true.
And that's one of the things that in the past were leading to irreconcilable differences.
Yeah.
You can either decide to, let's set aside that, respect each other's histories, but figure out what we're going to do for
mm-hmm,
tomorrow,
because
mm-hmm. fighting hasn't gotten us anywhere. Or keep arguing things.
Or as it has been in the past, put it in the back burner. I mean, it was somehow
sort of agree to disagree. The only point that emerged to me very clearly, if you look at these things, anyone looking at it, is there are several sort of storylines here.
Yeah.
There is what is the dilemma of the heirs of the Sultanate of Sulu, in the terms of both the money they get, and who gets the money, and what happened to their old sort of rights when they were still a kingdom.
Yeah.
The second is the Philippines. What we know is the sort of arguments we were making in 1962, but the third story comes in, which is the world has changed. I mean, the world is a very different place from 1962. And therefore, have we played catch up, or are we in sync with sort of how the thinking goes?
Evolution,
yes.
Yeah. All right. I wish we had more time. But yeah, we're going to have to go, and thank you, of course, Manon. It's good to see you again.
Thanks.
I hope we were able to help our viewers understand this better. I mean, it helped me, but frankly, I need more time to actually talk to you about this. It's quite complicated and very historical.
And meanwhile, let's not forget that there are 800,000 of our countrymen, and also the people affected in Tawi-Tawi and Sulu. And that sort of thing. So let's keep our fingers crossed for that.
Yes, of course. Manolo, good to see you. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
All right, what's next for the MRT's bus charter system?